matter to come before the court this morning is State of Ohio versus Anthony W. Davis. Both sides will have 15 minutes to present oral argument. The appellant may reserve up to 5 minutes for rebuttal. If you're the appellant, wish to reserve any time for rebuttal. If you let me know when you get started, I'm keeping the clock and I can keep your advice to the passage of time. We have ready to see when you are.
I'll reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal. Good afternoon, Giovanna Scaletta Brumke. I represent Mr. Anthony Davis. In this case, he was indicted in 2016 on 7 separate counts, including multiple counts of murder. His counsel had filed a motion to suppress, which is the sole assignment of error deals with that suppression issue. The motion to suppress is attached to my brief as A3. A hearing was held on that suppression on October 4th, 2016. And it was denied in what is attached to A2 to my brief. The case proceeded to jury trial in January 2017, and the jury returned a verdict of guilty on all counts and specifications. In this case, the facts are disputed but significant. I guess the facts of the event aren't necessarily in dispute, but there was a dispute over grandchild babysitting and Mr. Davis and his girlfriend, who they nicknamed as Coco. There was a tussle, there was guns involved, and Coco was left dead. Mr. Davis left the home. He was walking towards the police station. He stopped at a home and sat on the porch, and officers came in an unmarked vehicle and found him there. They informed him that he had a warrant for his arrest, and he had guns drawn at that point. And again, I'm going to address the dispute and what the state claims as the facts and what Mr. Davis claims. But Mr. Davis had testified that he was handcuffed. And then he was asked, what did you do with the gun? And his response to that was, I threw it in the river. And then they asked, why did you kill her? To which he shrugged his shoulders and shook his head. Then he went to the station. He was interviewed. He invoked his right to counsel after being advised of his Miranda rights. And the interview stopped. The next day, he had asked the guard to speak with the detective again. At that point, he made he waived his Miranda rights and made some incriminating statements. The dispute in the facts are that the officer testified that he was not handcuffed at the time that he was posed these two questions. And I put in my brief, and I agree with this, that it's not all that relevant whether he was handcuffed or not, because the standard is whether he was deprived of freedom and whether a reasonable person would what they would understand in that situation to be deprived of freedom. The officer had testified that he was not free to leave. So, and that is on the transcript, page 11. The counsel asked at that point, you confronted my client on the street, was he free to leave? Just turn around and walk away. Officer Rodriguez said, no, sir. So, again, that dispute in facts for our determination here, it's not all that relevant because either way he was not able to leave, even if he was handcuffed or not. And he would, Mr. Davis would have that same reasonable expectation that he wasn't free to leave because the officer felt that way. Then the second dispute in the facts is the questions that were asked. So Mr. Davis had said that he was asked, what did you do with the gun? And he responded again, I threw it in the river. The officer Rodriguez said that he had asked, that he had done a pat down, and that he had asked where was the gun, to which Mr. Davis responded, I don't have a weapon, I threw it in the lake. So similar answer, but a little bit different, lake versus river. But the way the question was proposed, what did you do with the gun versus where is the gun? And also, there was a second question of why did you kill her? Which there was no verbal response, but there was a shrug of the shoulders and a head shake.
That doesn't seem to be subject to the motion to suppress, right?
The second question, there's the two questions, but the biggest one is, what did you do with the gun?
So the gun.
Right.
And when he asked to speak to the detective, how many, was that 2 days later?
It was a holiday weekend, so I believe it was that Monday that he would have asked. I believe it was a day later that he had asked.
Did they actually question him at the station the same day he was arrested? I thought it was the next day.
It was the same day. I believe it was late at night, so there might have been, issue of midnight
after midnight.
Right. But like I said, there was an issue in the suppression hearing about it being a holiday weekend, because normally he would have been in court on that Monday and gotten counsel, but he didn't because of the holiday.
So after he requested to speak with the detective a day or 36 hours later, whatever it was, he was Mirandized again. He waived his rights. There's no dispute about that.
No.
And then what statements did he actually give? Did he talk about the gun at that point?
He did. They were statements that were in line with what he, what these initial two statements were. They were very similar to that, to those statements about throwing the gun and the lake or the river.
With the initial suppression issue regarding the dispute back as to whether the officer asked him, what did you do with the gun, or do you have a gun on you? The trial court said that he felt that the officer was credible and believed the officer. So what do we do with that, because with our standard of review?
Right, so and that's important. So the trial court made a determination that it's logical that an officer, for his own safety, would ask a question about where the gun is. I'm asking that there's a difference between a logical conclusion from the trial court and a conclusion based on credible evidence. So, and you're going to ask me what the difference is. To me, logical is, 1 + 1 = 2. You know that because you put two things together and you know that. Whereas credible would be, you tell me 1 + 1 = 2 and I believe it because I believe you're credible. So I think the trial court made this determination that it would be logical, not that Officer Rodriguez was credible in saying that that's what happened. He made a conclusion saying, it's logical that that could have happened that way because an officer might fear for his safety.
Really what it boils down to is, do we believe the officer asked, do you have any weapons, or do we believe that Mr. Davis said, the officer said, where'd you put the gun? The credibility is really what I guess the court found was the officer asking, do you have a weapon, was more credible than asking, hey, where'd you put the gun?
Right.
Under the circumstances at that moment in time.
Well, I believe he makes a logical, his decision against Pat is based on logic and not on credibility. So, he could have made that decision based on the credibility, but again, I believe he's saying it's logical that could have happened. I'm not, Officer Rodriguez is credible, and that's why, I'm coming to this conclusion.
But the problem with your analysis is, I think that the court said both. The court said, I find his testimony credible, and then kind of supported it, was saying it's only logical that this would happen. So I'm not sure. Or are you saying that the only reason he found him credible was because of his...
Because of the logic.
He didn't say he found him credible.
Right, and again, I mean, I think it could go either way. You could also say it's logical that it's more likely to have a response of, I threw it in the river, with a question of where is the gun versus, you know, where, versus what did you do with the gun? So, again, that certainly what Mr. Davis's testimony is a more, it's a question that's more of an interrogation versus a safety, the way it's posed. Where is the gun is asking for interrogation for evidence in the case versus, or what did you do with the gun versus, you know, do you have the gun on you? Essentially, it's a safety versus versus an interrogation for evidence in the case question.
And you're just now reaching into that 5 minutes.
Hours are pressing.
Davis objected to the admission at trial of his interview with Detective Siebert. However, he never objected during trial to Officer Rodriguez's testimony regarding his question about the weapons and Davis's answer at the scene of the arrest, which is the sole basis of his assigned error. Davis has waived all but plain error. However, he has not argued his assignment of error in those terms, and this court should not undertake the plain error analysis on his behalf. Nevertheless, the state has responded to the merits of Davis's claims and submits that Miranda does not apply to Davis's spontaneous and unsolicited statements about the location of the gun when he responded that he threw it in the lake. The duty to provide Miranda warnings is only invoked when custody and interrogation coincide. Because an unsolicited and spontaneous statement is not the product of an interrogation, Miranda does not apply here. Davis's statement regarding the location of the weapon was unsolicited and spontaneous. Here, Officer Rodriguez testified that he and other officers were in the location of Hamilton Avenue when they spotted a male matching Davis's description. They approached the male, who was later identified as Davis, with their weapons out. Officer Rodriguez asked Davis if he had any weapons. Davis replied, "No, I threw it in the lake." At the time of this statement, Davis had not been secured. State submits that Davis' statement regarding the location of the weapon was unsolicited and spontaneous, and not the result of custodial interrogation, as Davis has argued. He was simply asked if he had any weapons and not the whereabouts of the murder weapon. It was Davis who volunteered that he had disposed of the gun in the lake. As to the issue of the credibility and differences in testimony, the state would submit that the trier of fact is to be given, that an appellate court gives deference to a trial court's finding of facts if they're supported by competent and credible evidence. And the credibility of the witness, the weight to be given the evidence, and the credibility of witness is primarily for the trier of fact. And here, the court's finding regarding the question that was posed to Davis by Officer Rodriguez was supported by competent and credible evidence, as the trial court found. Officer Rodriguez testified that he asked Davis if he had any weapons. Now, what did you do with the gun? And this court should grant deference to the trial court's finding that Officer Rodriguez was credible. Even if this court were to find that Officer Rodriguez's question was part of a custodial interrogation, the state submits that Davis' statement was still admissible under the public safety exception to the Miranda requirement, as the trial court also found. Under this exception, police officers can ask a suspect without giving Miranda warnings if they they can ask a suspect questions without first giving Miranda warnings if they reasonably believe it is necessary for their safety or the public's safety. The state cited to a case, State v. Neyland, Ohio Supreme Court case, which had similar facts, where an officer asked a murder suspect who had been placed on the ground, had been handcuffed, but before being handcuffed, if he had any weapons. And the suspect responded, "No, the gun is in the truck by the door." The Supreme Court found that the question regarding the weapon was warranted under the public safety exception to Miranda because the gun had been used recently in a murder, and they were in a public parking area of a motel, and the gun would have posed a threat to safety. Here, Officer Rodriguez's question to Davis was in similar circumstances and falls under the public safety exception. Officer Rodriguez was aware that Davis was a homicide suspect and that a gun had been used to kill Karina Charlton the previous night. They were located in a residential area when Davis was located, and a gun would have posed a threat to public safety. The case is similar to Nyland, and Officer Rodriguez's question regarding the weapons was warranted by the public safety exception and correctly admitted at trial. The remaining issue for this court relates to the statements Davis made to Detective Siever in a subsequent interview at the station. It's settled that a custodial interview must cease once a suspect invokes the right to counsel, but after a suspect invokes the right to counsel, he may be reinterrogated if he initiates further discussion and knowingly and intelligently waives his right to counsel. The state would submit that Detective Siever properly reinterrogated Davis. On the day of his arrest, Davis was transported to the police station, and Detective Siever met with him in an interview room. Detective Siever advised Davis of his Miranda rights, and Davis signed a standard Miranda rights waiver form. Shortly thereafter, Davis referenced an attorney, and Detective Siever immediately ceased the interview. It was the next day when, at the city jail, Davis contacted a jail worker and requested to speak to Detective Siever, who was then contacted and came to the jail, or came to the station, and then spoke to Davis. Detective Siever confirmed with Davis that he had initiated a contact. Davis testified at the suppression hearing that he made the request to speak to Detective Siever. Davis was again read his Miranda warnings and signed a waiver of these rights. It was only after this waiver and reading of the rights that Davis confessed to the murder and made statements about the whereabouts of the gun. So we would submit that Detective Siever was permitted to question Davis outside the presence of an attorney because Davis had initiated the further discussions and he had knowingly and intelligently waived his right to counsel prior to the interview taking place. The trial court correctly denied Davis's motion to suppress, and we would request that the decision of the trial court be affirmed. Thank you, Your Honors.
Thank you.
Um,
to address the second interview with Detective Seibert, the day after Miranda rights were waived. I would submit that is a continuation of the first interview. There's a case that I cite, that's State versus Tate. It's a Seventh District case in which there was an individual who was interviewed. The officers realized that they hadn't started the video recorder. They went and got the video recorder, came back in, read the Miranda rights. They were waived. And the interview proceeded and was videotaped. That court had held that all of the statements should be suppressed and excluded from the trial because it's a continuation of the same interrogation. I would submit again that even though this was a little bit different in that it was a day later, Mr. Davis in the trial court makes reference to this in its decision on page 3, that he had put, and it's the motion to suppress the state's exhibit 2, the waiver puts on there, he puts, before I made it to this point, I was questioned without rights being read. And again, that's dating back to those initial statements about the gun and their whereabouts. And those same questions were asked on that second, so at this point, he was asked questions at the time that he was arrested and then at the station, and then this is the third interview really. And his statement is dating back to those initial questions about where to go.
The interviews are all recorded, right?
They are recorded, and that's...
Was there anything in that, did the detective ask him anything about that waiver when they sat down the second time?
I don't believe so. I believe he had signed it in hand, wrote it in.
For the second interview, for the third time, when evidently Davis is the one who requested the interview.
Right.
When he was read as Miranda right at that time, did the detective mention to him anything about the last time you signed this waiver, you wrote this on here? I mean, is that in any of the recordings?
It was the third time that's when he had wrote it on there. The second time, he didn't waive. He had invoked his right to counsel. He said, I'm not going to waive my Miranda rights. I want to stop the interview. They stopped the interview. It was what we're calling is the third interview where he had called the detective. That's when he had waived his right and he had put on the waiver. Before I made it to this point, I was questioned without reading my rights.
That's not how I'm reading the judge's decision. Okay. I'll go back and look at it again.
Yeah, that's the detective with the interview with Detective Seibert. That's the one he had waived but he had also wrote that note on there. The third page of the judge's decision?
Where it's at the top of the page, it says the day after his arrest, he had an interview and he signed the waiver saying, I'm retaining my. There
right.
was a question about, okay. Then he goes, presumably he left because the next day, he signs another waiver. That's the one I'm asking you. At that time when he signed another waiver, did Detective Seibert mention anything about, well, yesterday you signed a waiver, but you wrote this on there. Today you're signing a waiver, but you didn't write anything on there. Or are you waiving what you didn't want to waive yesterday? There's no discussion of that.
There's no discussion.
Okay. All right. That's all I'm asking.
No, I see what you're saying. He'd stopped. Right.
He signed it as is without any modifications.
Right.
That's what I'm asking.
Right.
I'm asking, was there discussion about the fact that there's no modification this time? And you're telling me we don't know?
No.
Okay.
They're about 20 seconds.
Unless there's any questions,
thank you both. Thank you for the attention today. The court will take the matter under advisement. We will issue a written decision, which will be mailed to both sides, as well as listed on the Ohio Supreme Court.